Yeah. Let's talk about me as Tom Ryan's favorite game of all time.
I was reading the comments from everyone, man. They're like yeah, you're going to, you know, Todd's going to sit back and Tom's just going to talk about himself. It's like, wow.
Todd lets me get a word in edgewise.
Yeah, this is going to be great. I'm so glad you guys joining me tonight and just to have a good time. I think the last time I had you guys on was like episode 46 about a couple years ago. So it's been about 2 years since I've had both of you on it.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, probably
when we were working on the first anthology.
Yeah. Yep. So, all right, we got some views.
Podcast City Network.
Listener discretion is advised.
You're listening to The Everett Lee Show. A shot of entertainment to the head. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the entertainment.
What's happening, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome to another episode of the Everett Lee Show podcast. I am the Everett Lee. I want to give a shout out to everyone who follows me on social media over on Facebook, Everett Lee Show, on Twitter, at the Everett _ Lee, and right here on Podcast City Network, the official host of the Everett Lee Show. You may notice I'm streaming back on Podcast City Network's Twitch channel tonight, and of course on my Everett Lee Show Facebook page, the Everett Lee Show. But hope everyone's having a good night and going to have a fantastic, amazing podcast tonight because I have returning back on the podcast. They haven't been on here since episode 46 and we're up to, I think, this is episode 164. So it's been a minute since I've had both guests on at the same time. Tonight, I want to welcome to the program none other than film director and producer Tom Ryan and film producer and maybe director, we can add that to your credit there, Todd Sturuch.
Hey, Denver, what's going on?
Not much, man. Not much.
Good evening.
It's great to have you guys both back on, man. It's been a while since I've had you both on the program, man. It's been, what, about a couple years since I've had you both back on?
Yeah, it's been a couple of years. Yeah, quite a stretch, man. It feels like it was just yesterday.
I know. It feels like I just had you on just like last week talking about the Theater of Terror anthology, man. I mean, I know a lot's been going on since I last talked to you. What's exactly been going on? Feed me some details, man, on what's been happening since I last talked to you.
Yeah, so we enjoyed a lot of success with the Theater of Terror anthology. People really liked our stories, our format. We had some really successful screenings. We got a lot of great feedback. We recently secured a distribution deal with Bayview Entertainment for the film.
Really successful
It's really resonated well with the audience. And so we collectively discussed our next move as the Theater of Terror, and we decided that we were going to dive into a follow-up anthology. We had some more short stories to tell, some more eerie tales of terror, and so we got a full head of steam. We're pursuing that right now. We start shooting in February.
Excellent, excellent. I love the post up on the Theater Anthology Facebook page there. With everything that's come out and it's been happening, I do want to say, man, congratulations on the New York City Film Festival where you've won like an awards for like best actor in a sci-fi short with Russell Hackett and best director of a sci-fi short. yourself there, Tom. And best sci-fi short.
Thank you.
For Abducted. You're welcome. It's just...
Yeah, thanks very much. Yeah, that was great. That was actually the Cutting Room Film Festival. Just a wonderful event, a wonderful venue, and a great night for us. And yeah, they loved Abducted. Abducted has been one of the more well-received shorts from the bunch. A lot of people really enjoyed that segment. It's a favorite of a lot of our fans and our friends. And at that film festival, it was really it went well, and we had a great audience reception. And we were very pleased to have won those awards. Russell Hackett for Best Actor, and I got Best Director, which was a shock and very humbling and exciting. And it was just great. It was a great team win that night, and a wonderful film festival.
Nice.
Yeah, I gotta give props too to Russ for that. You know, when you find someone who can fit a very specific role really well, mm-hmm. it's a great thing. And we like to tease Russ on set, you know, but it's all in fun. We take a lot of shots at each other to kind of keep things light on set. Because I'll tell you, we froze our asses shooting that film, you know, uh-huh. out in the woods in the middle of the night, you know, in 20 something degree weather, and everyone just did a kick-ass job. And Russ was great. So he won a couple of Best Actor awards for Abducted, and they were well-deserved, as were all the other accolades for everybody else for that film. Very, very well-deserved.
Nice. Nice.
Yeah, that was Russ's second Best Actor award for that performance. So he definitely, Russ found that character.
Oh, nice. Nice. And that's Abducted. Now, the theater anthology films is a collection of short films. And what people that's not familiar with it, can you explain what the Theater of Terror anthology is about?
Well, it's basically a throwback anthology. You have your four short stories, and we have a wraparound narrative. It basically centers around a young girl by the name of Amber that volunteers to help a theater that's in danger of being closed and needs volunteers to help them renovate and to keep the place operational. When she arrives there, the theater is already closed. She's too late, but this caretaker of the theater invites her in for a tour of the theater, and she begins to watch these four short stories. There are loose connections from each short, from one to the other. They're all very different genres, dark drama, creature feature, sci-fi, and a horror. There's loose connections between all of them, but it's really her story in that theater that connects all of them. I don't want to give away exactly what's happening there, mm-hmm. but with our follow-up anthology, Return to the Theater of Terror, a nice throwback title we wanted to use as well, but that one is going to, that we're probably going to follow suit with what that narrative was in the first film. So that's a little tidbit there that we're kind of going with. So
if anybody, go ahead.
I was gonna say I saw the poster, the that list all the movies for the Return of the Theater of Terror. The listing and the names, the shorts sound amazing. They sound really interesting.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, we're really excited about this these new shorts that we've got, because you know, once again we get to play with a lot of different actors. A lot of different stories and characters, some different effects artists were getting involved in this follow-up film. And so in regards to visual effects, which we're adding to the menu this time, and we're still old school. We do all practical effects, but regarding some of these films, there's just nothing we can do practically. In some instances. So we're incorporating that into our production. And we're just excited because these stories are, it's just some of our best stuff. And I think it's going to be very much like the first one. It's going to be a nice variety of storytelling And definitely with that Twilight Zone feel, where I think we're going to creep people out with some of these. So it's going to be a lot of fun.
Nice. Nice. What you wanted to add, Todd, before we...
I don't know. I forgot. That was like 3 minutes ago. So I'm forgetful these days. Now, what I was going to say was it's very... As Tom mentioned, just to piggyback what Tom said, it's very reminiscent to movies like Twilight Zone, the movie, mm-hmm. Creepshow, yeah. Dr. Terror's House of Horrors, you know, Asylum, things like that, where they're very distinct individual stories,
right.
But there's a sort of a thread that winds through all of them, binding them together. When you know, the first project came around, I'm a huge fan of horror anthology. So mm-hmm. when Tom came and said, hey, I'm working on an anthology, I said, I'm in. You don't even have to say anything else. I'm in, you know, just because I love that. I, for whatever reason, I just love that format. So I'm psyched to get started on the new one. We do have four really strong stories. And one thing, when we sat down to talk about the next project, we said, We feel we did a really, really good job on the first one, mm-hmm. but we want to try to step up our game on the second one and just learn and build on what we've done before and just take it up a notch, whether it's with the acting, the direction, the writing, the music, the effects. We want to just take everything to the next level and just better ourselves in general and just really blow everyone away with this next one.
Mm-hmm. That's amazing, man. That's amazing. I love the titles, man. Soothsayer, Robot, Splinter, and my eyesight is just killing me. I got this on my
haunted.
Yeah. It's just on my end there. My screen is just for what I'm using is like downsized. It did an update, and I'm sitting there squinting. I'm like, damn, I got to pull the monitor closer. I'm going to have to get some fucking glasses.
Technology's great.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it is. It is. I'm excited. I wasn't able to purchase the DVD Blu-ray off your website. But I did read today or a few days ago that on February 25th, it's going to be distributed on Bayview Entertainment and it's going to be streaming on Amazon. Is that correct?
Yeah. So as far as the streaming, that hasn't been confirmed yet.
Okay.
But that's still being negotiated, but they have released it on DVD and Blu-ray. And it's through quite a few sites like Barnes and Nobles and Amazon Prime and a few other outlets like that that you can order it online. I think now you could pre-order it. I did see links for it, so I'm not sure if it. I might already be available, but February 25th was the announced date when it would be available. But yeah, we're excited about that. Bayview's been great to us, and you know, I'm really looking forward to working with them and you know, hopefully with this follow-up film, we might develop a relationship with them. But they've been really good with us communication-wise and just what they've kind of, you know, discussed what we're looking at here just as far as getting our film out to the public, which is really important to us to just get out to a broader audience. So the kind of stuff that we've discussed, which is our vision for Theater of Terror, is kind of coming to fruition, and it's paid off the hard work that we put in.
Oh, yeah. It has, man. I mean, just winning awards at film festivals and just the throwback to the classic, like Twilight Zone, like you mentioned. I remember watching the Twilight Zone movie in the beginning of it. That scared the shit out of me, man. And the remake, I know they did. That's the one I saw. I never really I remember watching, like, years ago, Sci-Fi did like a marathon of the Twilight Zone, and me and my friends we sat there and we watched it, and it was like, this is some great stuff, man. And just having the little short stories and stuff and week by week, but it was just everything was solid and put together so well. And another like anthology that was released was Creepshow 1 and 2. I remember Creepshow 2 really well.
Yeah. I love both of them. All the stuff that we've done with these films definitely comes from that place. And especially the reason we always reference The Twilight Zone or The Outer Limits or Night Gallery is because a lot of people that are not necessarily horror fans were fans of those shows, those eerie stories, those kind of twisted tales, because it's not over the top violence or in some cases you might have it in our short. It's not the focus, I don't think, and it's not an important element of it. I think our storytelling is what is really influenced by watching anthologies like The Twilight Zone. It's like they could really draw you in with a story that has nothing frightening about it, just something very eerily depressing, morbid, and miserable about what happens to the character. And that's something that we definitely try to achieve with these. That's the kind of storytelling that we're trying to achieve, because I feel that it really appeals to a broader audience than if we just kind of made another slasher flick. And without any offense to slasher flicks, I love them, but I don't feel like we have anything to offer that genre right now, or that specific type of, character. But this stuff, we've got just a great variety of subject matter at our disposal. Because, we have a broader audience that we can appeal to.
Right. Twilight Zone. What would be your favorite episode of Twilight Zone? I have a couple that were my favorite. What would be one of your favorites that you can think off the top of your head? Like the classic Twilight Zone. What would be your favorite episode?
Go ahead. Why don't we let Todd answer that while I think about it?
Oh, wow. There's so many, but, there's so many that are really good. I mean, I think It's a Good Life is probably one of my favorites. It brings the phrase "wish it into the cornfield" into the mainstream, because it's just so creepy. Right. Like, everybody remembers Opie, Will, and Will Robinson, and then to have him as that kind of a horrific character really gets to everyone. Time Enough at Last with Burgess Meredith, just because it's such a downer. Like, it's, this guy just, all he wants to do is have time to read. And, finally he can. And what happens? He drops and he breaks his glasses. And you're like, oh, man, didn't see that coming.
Yeah.
And then finally, probably, I can't remember the title of it, but there's an episode. It's with William Shatner, of all people. And he's in a diner and, he's getting his car fixed. He's with his fiance and he's playing with one of them fortune teller machines. And the fortune teller, like, he starts to believe that it really can predict the future. And it's starting to control his life, And then finally he's able to break free and they leave the town. And what do we see coming into the diner? Another couple that are hopelessly addicted to this fortune teller machine. And they just do whatever it says. And it literally won't let them leave the town. So they're just stuck there. So, any of the stories that kind of have those sort of, oh no, twists at the end, and to Tom's point, that's what we were going for. It seems, just to take a quick side note here, it seems that like there's so many indie films today that rely on violence and gore, and there's definitely an audience for that. Like, I'm a bit of a gore hound,
right?
But we found, like, even like at the conventions and the festivals and stuff where we were selling the movie, we were able to get a lot more people interested and ultimately have a lot more sales by appealing to that audience that wasn't really looking for the over the top violence. So,
right.
That's why we relied on stories like that, where they do have a bit of a morbid kind of ending, but not necessarily a violent one. So,
Yeah.
Oh my God, I could go on and on for hours about the Twilight Zone, so I'll turn it over to Tom.
Yeah, so the episodes that Todd mentioned, those are some of my favorites too.
Right.
Another one that I saw recently in the marathon that I'd forgotten about that I really like is, and forgive me, but I'm not going to remember the titles to any of these. These three soldiers return in this crashed aircraft, and two of them are in the hospital. And one by one, they start to cease to exist.
Uh-huh.
And but they're kind of, everyone forgets who they are. So basically, one guy's left in the hospital. One guy recovers and goes with the second guy to go have drinks, and something's happening to that second guy, and he's acting strange, and he goes into the phone booth and he just disappears, and the army buddy that saw him disappear is like panics, and he turns to everybody and says, "Did you see what happened to him? What happened to him?" And everybody's like, "Who are you talking about?" And a minute ago, everyone was just talking to the guy and they saw him, but they would forget that he existed immediately. And by the end of the episode, all three of them cease to exist. And no one around them remembered it. So it was almost like an episode that meant that they maybe should have been dead,
right,
but they survived the accident. But then they, you know, it was kind of rectified by fate somehow. But that was a great episode. I mean, I could just go on and on. The one where the guy has the gambling problem and the slot machine comes into his room in the hotel room.
Yeah. That was like crazy.
It's like an addiction episode. Yeah. It's like an episode about addiction. Really just great storytelling and just fun. I don't know. I mean, I could name 100 episodes. It would just take me a while to remember each and every one.
One of the episodes that sticks in my head, that sticks out to me, was the episode where the guy travels back in time because he to make it rich, and the beginning of the episode, he's like well known, and he's like there's a janitor involved. And you probably know which one I'm talking about, where he goes back in time and he's going to make it rich. He's going to make it. And there's gold or whatever it is, or oil underneath the town. And he's like, you know what's underneath there? It's oil or gold. And I'm going to make it, and I'm going to dig it out and be rich. And they're like, yeah, we know it's down there. And he was all shocked about it. And they're like, yeah, it's like we can't get it out because of the technology and stuff. And he ends up like becoming like a homeless person in the future, and then the janitor becomes,
gotcha.
Yeah, you know which one I'm talking about. That one was
I do remember that one.
Yeah,
and you just made me I just recalled one last one I'll mention that I think is great. It's the guy with the dummy. He's the ventriloquist. And the dummy's talking to him. He's got a really bad attitude with him, and the dummy murders someone, and I forget. I think at the end, the dummy is in the guy, and the guy is in the dummy.
Yeah.
If I'm right about that switch, but I know that the dummy is definitely in the guy.
Yeah,
it is a switch, because at the end, the guy comes out, and he resembles the dummy, and the dummy is looks more like the actor who played the guy. So, they changed the dummy. So, yeah, that one was a very creepy episode, if you ever saw that one.
Yeah, I remember that one, man. That was creepy.
The dummies always get.
Yeah, those dummies. Those dummies,
right,
man.
You big dummy.
Yep.
Well, Twilight Zone inspired my hatred of ventriloquist dummies and porcelain dolls, all because of Talky Tina. You remember the episode? I'm talking Tina, and I'm going to kill you.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
God, the creepy.
Fuck that doll. Fuck it in a fire, I swear to God.
Yeah,
I get.
Wait, am I allowed to curse? Am I allowed to curse on the show? I can't remember.
Yeah, there's no filter, man. That's why I throw the prevent advisory up at the beginning of the episode. No filter.
I guess it's too late now. I already did it.
Oh, shit. Yeah, the porcelain dolls, man, those things creep the shit out of me. They always have. And what made it worse was when they started doing those movies with Annabelle, the doll. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? We got another commercial, trailer for a killer doll. I mean, I can stand Chucky, but like, just, I don't know. They just stand there and just stare at you, you know, just... looking at you.
Oh, they're fucking evil. No, at least you look at Chucky and you're like, yeah, that fucking thing is going to kill somebody. Mm-hmm. But dolls are like supposed to be things that like children play with and they're nice and everything. But no, barf that. They're fucking evil. And that's that. They should all be burned in a giant bonfire.
Damn. That's crazy. That's crazy.
Yeah.
I've seen some pretty good movies over the last few weeks. And I watched a couple weeks ago, I watched a movie from another independent film director and producer up in New York there, Hilton Aero Ruiz. He finally released Zombie with a Shotgun, and I watched it on Amazon Prime, loved it, and loved everything he did with the movie. Then this past weekend, I sat down and I watched Jeremiah Kemp's Black Wake, and
there you go.
Yeah,
such a fun movie to work on.
I bet, because I was watching that movie and I'm sitting there watching and just getting the story. I'm like, this is pretty damn good, and just watching it. And I'm in the back of my head, I'm like, where is Tom? Where's Todd? Where are they? And all of a sudden, Todd shows up, and then I'm like, cool fishing vest. And then and then they show Tom, you know, going to the beach. You know, he's like sitting there, you know, with the fishing pole. He's like, yeah, popping a beer, drinking it. And then I just started rolling when the part where the guy comes walking, and then here comes Tom rolling, just tuck and roll. And he's like, hey man, you okay? And then just I loved it.
Yeah, that was a great day on set. That's one of those experiences that I'll never forget. And Jeremiah is a great friend, and he's a great director. And it's awesome because, you know, once in a while he could pull us in on some of his projects, and to work on that one was a lot of fun. And that was a day, and it was literally a day on the beach. And working in the sand, and I think that might have been the first time I met Beatrice Sniper, the effects artist, and she did the kind of splitting head gag. Uh-huh. That day, and she's just the greatest. It's just such a pleasant group of people to work with, and just having fun making a creepy creature feature monster movie. So mm-hmm. I enjoyed the hell out of it. And what's great is that I'm playing the fisherman, and Todd is also playing a fisherman. And I had no idea that him and I were basically, our characters were friends in the film, because we were never on set together for the entire film.
Right.
But we are friends in the movie. And so that was a lot of fun when we actually went to the premiere to see the scene play out, and to see that we were the friends, and the way it was cut together. It was just a lot of fun. And just such a cool movie. And Sarah Schuch is in that, and Pat Devaney, and Kelly LaGault is in it. I mean, there's so many great people that we know that were in that film, and a lot of us got to go and play make-believe together on the beach. It was great.
Hell yeah.
It was great. Like, and so Jeremiah tells me, look, yeah, it's going to be like in 2 days, I need you on set. Oh, and you're going to be a fisherman. I'm like, fuck, I haven't been fishing in like 30 years. So I run to like Dick's Sporting Goods and I buy like a tackle box. And then I buy this fishing vest. Like, I hope no one really pays attention, because it really doesn't fit. It looks like I bought it at like the children's place, you know? And I like, look, whatever you do, Jeremiah, try not to make it too obvious, like, that I'm a fat guy wearing a fishing vest that's way too
big. In a little coat.
You know, like, yeah. It looks like, yeah. Yeah, so I could put it at Baby Cat, you know, but it was a lot of fun, you know, and Jeremiah kept telling me, oh, the editor kept saying, oh, we love this guy, we love this guy. I'm like, I got like 3 lines in the movie, like, what are they talking about? But it was a lot of fun, and like Tom said, we know a ton of the people that were in that movie. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like a who's who of local indie talent, and that's one of the things I love about Jeremiah. Like, he's always thinking of the other person. Like whenever there's a project coming up where he needs extras or someone to do a quick cameo, he'll always reach out to like the same core group of us to get us to participate. Right. And we've all been in a bunch of his movies. Tom and I don't want to give anything away, but I'll just say that Tom and I were just recently in another Jeremiah Kipp project together, you know?
Yep.
Because he's always thinking of the local New York, New Jersey indie film community. And that's one of the things I like about him.
Yeah, we work for beer, so.
Yeah, exactly. That's good.
Exactly. That's good. Hey, I need you for a shoot.
We come cheap.
Hey, we need you for a shoot. Bring a six pack. I'll be right there. I'll be right there. It's like my cousin. I lived up in Tennessee. I asked my cousin. I needed some help on working on changing out. I had a regular stereo in my car. I bought this AM FM CD player. I mean, it was badass. The faceplate came off. It was one of those ones that you buy at like a Walmart, Kmart for like, you know, whatever it is. But I was like, I need some help getting in. Well, I'm kind of busy and stuff. And I was like, I guess I'll put it in myself and have a cold one. You use a cold one? I was like, yeah. Give me a six pack and I'll be right there. I was like, okay. Yeah. I'll tell you what though, but by the time we got done putting that radio in, radio worked, but everything else in the car didn't. Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, we had to rewire it the next day, man. Freaking headlights wouldn't come on. And just to come to find out, our good friend was like, my cousin Jason, his nickname was Spud. We called him Spud. He's like, you had Spud work on the car? Yeah. He's like, God dang it, man. He's like, you don't need the solder stuff. They got a kit to put on the back now. You don't need to cut wires. It's like, oh, I didn't know that. He's like, bring the car over, I'll fix it. So we fixed it. And in the first CD I put in there to listen to was coincidentally a Rush CD. A Rush CD I have. I have like the double disc of their like greatest hits and stuff, and I love that CD. And I've listened to it here recently after the drummer passed away, man. And that hit me as much as it did you, Todd, man. Because Rush, damn, they had some really good songs, man. Really good stuff.
Yeah. That one hit me hard. Rush is my favorite band. It was so unexpected. You know, he was definitely the more reclusive of the three band members. So even the most hardcore fans, like, we didn't have any idea that he had brain cancer, you know? Right. So in fact, Tom, I didn't even know. I was very busy at work that day, so I wasn't really on social media or anything. Mm-hmm. And then I get a text from Tom, like, too bad about Neil Peart. And I'm like, well, what about Neil Peart? And so I, you know, went online, and I was hoping it was one of those hoaxes, you know?
Yeah.
But then it was everywhere. It was all over the place. And I'm like, no, it's true. So, and then my social media lit up, you know?
Right.
As far, you know, everything is subjective, right? Mm-hmm. But for my money, he was the greatest rock drummer of all time. And, I was very sad to hear that news. So, rest in peace, Neil.
Yeah. Yeah. It shocked me, you know, hearing that he ended up just, passing away. I mean, it really did get me there. Yeah. Yeah. You guys are still on. Are you there? Is Todd?
I'm here.
Yeah. Is Tom still there?
Don't know. Nope.
Nope.
Oh,
okay.
You know, good old Skype. Bro, looks like Skype blew him away.
you want to try calling him back?
Yeah. You know what? Fuck Tom anyway.
Oh, damn.
I'm just getting the rest of the show without him and, you know, talk about it behind his back. No, but then he'll cry about it. So let me, I'm going to call him back right now. So okay. Here we go.
Yeah. Anything happens live, especially on the Everett Lee Show, man.
Yeah, well.
It's like, yeah. And then I seen you and it's like, you guys still on?
Yeah.
You back, Tom?
Yeah, there's that.
There you are. Okay.
I was like, ah, fuck him. I'm just going to do the rest of the show without him and just say whatever I want about him.
Yeah, he's like, I'm taking over. I'm taking over.
Yeah, it was totally an accident that Tom dropped off the call. Totally an accident.
Yeah.
it's funny. I got some viewers in.
Yeah, good to be back.
Yeah, it's good to have you back, man. How was your trip?
It's great, man. It's great. Thanks. I needed the time off.
Get some.
He's like, thank God I had to pee like a racehorse.
Yeah.
Got some views in the chat on Facebook Live right here on the Everett Lee Show page. I want to give a shout out and thank everyone for tuning in tonight here with my guests Tom Ryan and Todd Starutch of the Theater of Terror Anthology. David C. Russell, he's laughing. He's LOL Todd always. It's always technical difficulty, Everett. Yeah. You can ask David because he knows. He's been in there with me a few times doing a podcast there. He hosts his own podcast, Deathmatch Russell Podcast, on Podcast C Network. And you do too, Todd, with Scott Culbert, The Imaginarium. I want to say congratulations on hitting over 200 episodes, man.
Yeah, man. I can't believe we've been doing that shit for so long. I mean, you know, I it seems like I've just been doing that show forever. And all kidding aside, it really is getting to do that show with Scott is one of the highlights of my week. Mm-hmm. It's so much fun and it's so irreverent and we just have a good time. So
yeah,
200 episodes. Jesus.
I know. I love the one with the when Tom, you got Tom on there, man. You guys, between you, Scott, and Todd, I mean, Todd, damn, that was great. That was a great episode, man. I loved it.
Yeah, we're gonna have Tom back on soon because we're nothing if not shameless self-promoters.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Tom and I are working on a movie together. Scott is working on his new book. So we're going to all get together and stroke each other's egos, among other things.
Bring your pillows.
Bring your pillows. Damn. That's great.
That's when the show took an unexpected turn.
Yes.
Wow. I know last time I had Tom on by himself, we were talking about Marvel movies and heavy metal. We're talking about Iron Maiden, Judas Priest. I mean, music I love listening to.
Oh, yeah.
And I wanted to ask you, how's Vlad the Inhaler? How's that been going for you there? How's the band?
It's slow going. You know, our last album, it's been probably about 4 years now. Uh-huh. I think since our last album, so it's been too long. It's been way too long, and we're trying to write stuff. It's you know, it's difficult, man, with the families and full-time jobs, and you know, even making movies is tough in that sense. And it's just it's a little bit slow going. You know, one cool thing is we do get a couple of jams in here and there. We all stay in touch. We definitely want to record a new album. I just don't know when that's going to happen. Hopefully it happens in the next couple of years. We've got some material that we've written that just needs to be worked on, and we just need to get together and find the time to do that. What's cool is that my guitar player, Anthony Lambides, and I have gotten to work on some stuff together that we've used in some of the films recently.
Yes.
And one of them is, I don't know if Todd wants to talk about this project right now, but I'm going to bring it up.
That's okay.
We dropped this, we dropped one of our songs in intro to a film that Todd has just recently directed. called The Bonds of Friendship that I also star in. And I edited the film, and so I dropped this music into the film. And so it's been cool that I've been able to work with Tony. Tony and I also wrote the song Devil's Hiding, which was the opening song in Abducted, when you kind of see all the scenes of the countryside. So it's been fun to work with him and drop some of these songs in some of these films. And but why don't I let Todd tell you a little bit more about The Bonds of Friendship, which I'm really kind of excited about for his first project. It's I think it's turning out really cool.
Nice.
Yeah, thank you, Tom. The Bonds of Friendship is a short film that I wrote and directed. I had been wanting to take a stab at directing for a while, and writing. I've worked as crew on a lot of films. I've acted in a few films, and I just had some stories percolating around in my head. And just some quick background, I had written a script called Splinter that was intended to be the first film that I wrote and directed. And then I felt it was a little ambitious for a first film. So Tom approached me and said, hey, how about we adapt this to be one of the short films in the new anthology? Mm-hmm. And then that way we'll have more resources. We'll have a bit of a budget so we could really do the film the way I really had envisioned it. So Tom mm-hmm. did some rewrites to the script to kind of fit it into the anthology. And I thought it's going to be really, really good. So I really wanted to take a stab at directing. So I wrote this tight little sort of crime drama, I guess you'd call it. Mm-hmm. It's only about 6 minutes, and it's about two, guys who have been best friends since they were little kids. They're like low-level criminals, uh-huh. and they're literally best friends. They have this unbreakable friendship, and then an incident happens that tests this friendship up to an extreme degree.
Right.
And the story basically tells what happens in the wake of this incident. So
nice.
I had a blast working on it. Tom and I play it's just the two of us.
Uh-huh.
And then there's another actress that does some voiceover. Mark Boutros did the cinematography, and I just wanted to see if I could write and direct a short film. And Tom just got done editing it together into a first cut, which came out really good.
Oh, nice.
We have to put some finishing touches on it.
Uh-huh.
And I hope to hit the festival trail with it this year. So yeah, I'm really excited about it. It was a great experience. I had a great time working with Tom and Mark and the other people that helped me out with it. And right. Yeah, so I'm looking forward to unleashing it.
That's amazing, man. That's amazing doing your first film and stuff. I mean, I'm sure you picked up quite a bit along the way working in movies and I mean, you got like the best circle of friends, with everyone that loves and enjoys making films, and that's amazing. I did see something about that a while back ago, and I looked and I was like, okay, this is gonna be pretty cool, man. I'd definitely like to see something like that, man. I definitely would.
You're 100% right. I could never possibly thank everybody enough. Just being in and around so many talented people now for about 10 years, and just watching and learning and observing, that's what led up to giving me confidence to try to write and direct something, right. And boy, was it an eye-opening experience for me. Mm-hmm. The amount of work that goes in to even directing and starring in just a 6-minute film.
Yeah.
I give all the credit in the world to people that act in and direct their own movies, because holy shit, that was hard.
I mean,
so I have a debt to people like Tom and Jeremiah and Pat Devaney and Manny Serrano and all the people that I've worked with and learned from over the years. It's a debt that I really never could repay, other than to just say thank you to everybody.
That's You're welcome.
that is amazing. I want to go back and just watch it, because I watched it. I watched it a while back ago. I think it was last year. I watched it. Was Faces. I love that. Me and Jeremiah Kemp, when I had Jeremiah Kemp on, he was talking about that. We mentioned Faces. We just love that, man. Just he loves it when the character that you play, Tom, is talking to all the faces in the wall and stuff. My favorite part of the movie is just how it ends, and I laugh, and it put a smile on my face how that movie ends, because it was great. You know, it's just a great movie all around.
Thank you. Yeah, of course, Faces will always be near and dear to my heart. That film was my first feature film, and I got to work with, you know, so many of my good friends, you know, Paul Gamitter, Dean Ademko, Tom Shore, like Carolyn Pizicki, Bradley Crienzo. There's just so many people that were involved in it. Mike Scardillo handled some special effects, and I just love being on set with Mike and making stuff bloody. And we just had a lot of fun making that movie. It was really an eye opener to the amount of work and the level of commitment you need to have and put into a film. And because I loved making Faces so much, I was there with it. But you know, it's kind of an eye opener that if you know anything less is not going to get it done.
Right.
And so, you know, when you got your back against the wall and you're making a film like this, and you're putting all your passion into it, you know, the audience is going to see the difference. You know, when you're putting that much into it, they're really going to notice it. And I think we did that with Faces. I mean, everybody put so much work into it and so many hours. We just had I think we had 17 shooting days.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And just the commitment from everybody involved. Joe Pariscand, who's kind of not in this doing acting anymore, but he was just great to work with on that. And just so many great people and great locations that we had for that. It was just a wonderful experience. I mean, I love when people reference it. And the film has its shortcomings technically, because back then we really didn't have the kind of gear that we have now and the resources that we have now. But
Right. With
that said, I think if you take it for what it is, it's like a really gritty little indie film that we shot entirely in my hometown of Jersey City. So it's a special film to me. And I'm so glad that people enjoy it, because, you know, speaking of my band, Vlad the Inhaler, that film is basically based upon a song that we wrote called Faces in the Wall.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we saw that come to life in the film. And yeah, it's I appreciate that you revisit that too, because I kind of consider it in my own mind a classic.
it was just so great, man. It's just seeing that character lose his mind, and just at the end of the movie, he's like, and I loved it. I love that, and just watching a movie like that, watching a movie like Black Wake and indie, you know, just indie films in general, because when I sit down and watch indie films, I know what to expect, and I know what not to expect, and just watch a great movie that someone that put together with a lot of good friends and a lot of close people that works with a director or producer and create something. And if I want to go see a blockbuster, you know, movie, I'd go see that, or I could watch indie. You know, you have that option there, and I do enjoy indie movies, because it's just there's so much passion behind it, and just how everything is done with a independent movie.
Yeah, I think there's a different level of appreciation when you see an independent film that you know did not have millions of dollars behind it, or the kind of access that a Hollywood studio would have, and you still see that someone can make a moving or a passionate, dramatic, scary, whatever their theme is, they can make a good version of that with very little resources. it reminds you about where the art comes from.
Mm-hmm.
It reminds you about where, you know, what can be done with resourcefulness, with passion,
right.
With hard work. And because, you know, we sometimes go to the movies now and you know, you have people criticizing, you know, multi-million dollar CGI effects because mm-hmm. the audience is kind of spoiled. Like when you have that, when you're throwing that much money at something, it seems like people, there's no place for imperfection in their viewing of this film. And what's great about indie stuff is that you appreciate some of the imperfections because you realize the lengths that these creators went to deliver their story to you. And this is why I love independent film festivals, because when you meet them and you're like, how did you do that? Or, oh my God, you were so great. What have you been in before?
Uh-huh.
And you just find so many talented people, you know, in that kind of a setting. And that's what I love about indie stuff. And that's what I love about the stuff that we do and what our colleagues and our friends do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's amazing what the stories that are told and how it's told. And when we were last talking, when I did mention about like bands and music stuff, we mentioned Marvel movies. Did you guys catch that Morbius trailer for Morbius the Living Vampire?
Yeah. Oh,
man. It gave me chills. And
I dig it.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm excited. I'm excited to see that, man, because reading in the comics growing up of him battling Spider-Man, and then even on the TV show, when they had the animated TV show I used to watch on Saturday mornings, they introduced like Blade and Morbius. That was just so great. And now actually seeing him like in person is fantastic. And I think that this movie, it's going to make people forget what Jared Leto did a few years ago, you know. And I think he's going I'm hoping he pulls it off. You know where I'm going at. I'm hoping this is like, he pulls it off, and I think he's going to, because he's done some great stuff, and I don't blame him for being pissed about Suicide Squad, man. I thought that was just wrong, you know.
Yeah, it's not his fault he was stuck with a shitty script. I like him as an actor.
Yeah,
and I'm looking forward to Morbius. I've always been a fan of like some of the lesser known characters, you know. Like I was thrilled when they, you know, announced they were making a Doctor Strange film. You know, I've always been a fan of Doctor Strange. And then when I heard about Morbius, I'm like, oh, thank God. I'm like, oh, this is going to be so cool.
Yeah.
And the trailer looks good. So listen, anyone who knows me knows that I am not one of these, you know, Facebook film critics, you know, who just wants to slam everything and pick apart everything. The movie will either be good or it won't, you know?
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to seeing it. It looks pretty cool, and I'm psyched for it, to be honest.
Yeah, I'm excited about it. How about you, Tom? You excited about this?
Yeah, the trailer looks good. Mm-hmm. And I think the casting is great.
Yeah.
I like Morbius. I don't know if I've been like the biggest fan of Morbius as far as like, if this movie never came out, I don't know if I would care. To be honest, you know what I mean? It's like, you know, now the Venom thing was a little bit cooler for me, I think, because I was looking forward to seeing that. But with that said, you know, what they're able to do now with some of these characters and bring them to life, and I think that, you know, I think they're basically trying to find that right formula with these, because this is Sony again, right?
Yeah.
So I think Sony's trying to find that right formula where they could kind of follow Marvel's thing, but with like, I think they're doing like a touch of the DC darkness to it, you know?
Yeah.
That's how Venom came across. And I think that's how Morbius, the trailer for Morbius, kind of comes across that way too.
Yeah.
So, I'm eager to see if they do a good job on it. I do like the character. But if it doesn't do well, I don't know if I'd be surprised.
Yeah.
Just because, again, I don't know how big of a character Morbius is going to be for people outside of comic book fans.
Yeah.
You know, like Spider-Man is like everybody knows Spider-Man. You know, even adults mm-hmm. that don't read comic books, they know who Spider-Man is or Superman. Or like those are characters a little bit easy to sell, easier yeah. to sell. But, you know, I have high hopes. I mean, listen, I'm a big fan, and we discussed this the last time. I'm a big fan of all the Marvel movies, and I like the DC movies too. Like, I just love to see these studios putting all my favorite old comic book characters on the screen. And my hope is always that they're just going to continue to get better at it, the storytelling and the visuals.
Yeah.
Because I just think it's amazing the stuff that they've done with, I never would have imagined in my wildest dreams that I'd see the Avengers on screen fighting with Thanos the way that they did
oh,
that.
Yeah.
Never would have imagined that. It would have been impossible. So I'm very appreciative of all that type of stuff. So I hope it does well. I hope it is good. I'm going to go see it. So.
Yeah.
Tom and I talk all the time. Like whenever I see someone come back from like Avengers, like Infinity War, say, and they're complaining, I'm like, you realize that when we were growing up, we watched like a bodybuilder spray painted green and we thought that was the coolest thing we had ever seen,
yeah.
you know, or Spider-Man like throwing ropes from his hands and we were blown away. Now we get to see these characters fully realized, like even like the shittiest Marvel movie, like I'm the biggest fan of say like Thor, the Dark World, but mm-hmm. it's still fucking Thor on
yeah.
the big screen.
Yeah.
You know? So I'm like, holy shit, I never thought I'd get this.
Yeah.
You know, to Tom's point, it's just amazing. So as far as I'm concerned, they could dig up some fucking character I never heard of, make a movie out of it, and I'll probably be okay with it. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's like Guardians of the Galaxy. No one really knew who the hell Guardians of the Galaxy were, except people that follow the comics, and they're like, oh yeah, these group of misfits.
Yeah.
And then when they're like, yeah, they're making a movie about them, I know a lot of people are like, yeah, that's gonna work. And what happened? They turn out to be like some of the best characters, likable characters, man, because they did something, you know. I mean, who would have thought, like, you know, me watching Dave Bautista, seeing him years in a WWE ring, you know, body slamming, kicking Triple H's ass and winning the World Heavyweight Championship at WrestleMania, and this guy's painted up, you know, as Drax the Destroyer.
Yeah.
I'm like,
yeah.
Are you fucking kidding me? You know, if I wonder,
you got a talking raccoon, a talking CGI raccoon, and a tree.
I know.
Diesel and Bradley Cooper, and it's James Gunn has the magic formula, man. He's,
yeah.
He's got the Midas touch when it comes to those films,
mm-hmm.
and
yeah.
I just think it's, you know, when you watch the films, you could see it, and Guardians of the Galaxy, my son absolutely loved it. It's one of my favorites.
Yeah.
You know, I sincerely believe this, that music has a hell of a lot to do with it.
Oh, God.
And
yeah.
the music that Gunn utilized on that soundtrack, it's just great, you know, great rock and roll throwback stuff that everybody likes. You might not have heard it in 20 years, but when you hear it, you like it. And it's just, you know, I think that in a lot of cases that helps to make the movie. And with that combination of characters, that music, and then the full power of Marvel behind him to do whatever he wanted to do visually. It's just, you know, it's like I said, these films are amazing.
Yeah, that's going to be it. It's I'm interested to see what.
Not cinema.
What's that?
No, I said, but they're not cinema.
Yeah, no, but they're fun and entertaining.
Yeah,
they're fun and entertaining, man. They're fun and entertaining. You go there for like a couple hours, an hour, 30 minutes, and just, you know, just watching these characters that you read in the comics. I was a big Thor fan. When they said Thor was coming to the big screen, I was 12 years old again. I loved it. And
yeah.
I'm interested to see what James Gunn does with Suicide Squad 2, because that's going to be interesting with him being in, you know, behind the director seat on that right there. You know, he's going to bring some of those elements.
Yeah, that
Guardians.
That is.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is interesting. And when I read that the other day, and I thought that was very interesting to kind of see how that's going to turn out. If that's going to revitalize DC.
Mm-hmm. It will.
I'm looking forward to Wonder Woman 1984. That looks freaking awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I'm looking forward to that one. Yeah, that looks amazing. I'm looking forward to that one. What about the Birds of Prey? That looks interesting there with Harvey Quinn and the rest of the cast there.
So-and-so.
I know.
I've seen it a few times now, mm-hmm. and I think that's the kind of movie that I'm either really going to love or I'm really going to hate. I don't think there's going to be any middle ground, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I just... I know DC, it's like DC rules. If you look at, I probably mentioned this to you last time I talked with you, Tom. DC, they rule the small screen, like especially like with the CW shows, like Arrow, Flash, Legends, Supergirl. Marvel rules. The big screen.
No, I'm sorry to cut you off. I was going to say, since we last talked, I remember that. And I have watched Flash and Arrow, and you're right. They're excellent. The shows are great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're great. I haven't kept up with them forever, but thank God, you know, I could go back and binge watch, you know. But it's funny because Todd made a point, and I was laughing about it because it made sense, you know, talking about the, like, complaining on Facebook. You could sit there and binge watch hours of your favorite TV show, but then when you sit down to watch Irishman, you're complaining because it's 3 hours.
I laughed.
Right. I was like, dead on, right. Man. Dead on. It's like, what the hell, people?
Hit the pause button, for God's sake.
Yeah, that's what I did. It's like when I watched, I forgot what movie it was. I think it was The Departed, because that was about 3 hours long, you know, with the Leonardo.
Well, Avengers Endgame was 3 hours.
Yeah. Yeah, I got up.
Avengers Endgame was 3 hours, yeah.
Yeah, when I went to go see it, me and my wife, we shared one drink, and I just sipped on it the whole time I was there. I didn't even get up and go to the bathroom once. Now, at home, I'm sitting there, you know, after a while there, you know, hit pause, get up, you know, get something to drink, come back, sit down, watch some, pause, get up, you know. So the three-hour movie took me almost about 4 hours, it seems like, but I enjoy it, you know.
Yeah.
But
movies used to have intermissions, can you imagine?
yeah whatever happened to that, man? You imagine if they did intermissions nowadays, people, it'd blow people's minds, wouldn't it?
Well, they did it when I went to go see The Hateful Eight.
Okay.
They did an intermission then. Mm-hmm. And that was the special, you know, opening of the film. They did an intermission for that, which is pretty cool, actually.
Nice.
Movie going used to be much more of an event. Like my grandmother gave to me before she passed away. I have a box. Like you used to go, if you went to see a big movie, I have some of these for the Ten Commandments, King of Kings, The Sound of Music. You used to actually get a program, you know. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and it would tell you, you know, when intermission was going to be, because going to the movies was like going to a Broadway show. It was, people would get dressed up, and going to the theater was a big event, you know.
Yeah.
Now it's like, oh, we're going to the multiplex. You know, there's 37 different movies showing. You know, it's not a big deal anymore. But listen, man, I'm in my 50s now. My bladder would love to have an intermission during I'll tell you that much.
Yeah, I'm right there with you, man. That is just, I'm 41, and still, it's just me and my wife do go out to the movies, end up getting a large drink, and we sit there and we sip on it together and stuff, and then about it, if it's like a 2 hour something movie there towards the end, and I'm sitting there, I'm rocking, I'm like, come on, end credits, you know. I mean, if I really have to go, I get up and go, and I come back and I'm there, you know. I'm like, honey, what did I miss? Oh, you missed this. You know, it's like, oh, okay.
It's just, listen, that's what the wide mouth Gatorade bottle is for, you know, so you don't have to get up. Just saying. I'm not sure the lady next to me last time appreciated it, but you know what? That's her problem.
Doesn't have good aim.
Yeah.
Damn.
She should sit somewhere else next time.
Me and my friends, when we'd go to the theater, it's funny to mention that, because when me and my friends, we went to the theaters one time, and we went, it was a couple times. One time we went to the theater, it was during like the holidays. We were all working our asses off. We had like one day off. What do we do? Let's go see Beowulf. Oh, that looks interesting. It's like one friend's like, yeah, Angelina Jolie's like, you know, it's like it's CGI, dude. It's like, you know, whatever. Let's go see it. So we went and seen it. During the middle of the movie, we're sitting right smack in the middle. I don't know why. Right smack into the theater there. We all fall asleep, man. We wake up towards the end of the movie, and everyone, we're getting up, we're leaving, and everyone's looking at us and stuff, and we're like, it was like, oops. It's like, we probably all were snoring. It's like, what the hell? But then another time, we snuck in snacks, man. We snuck in like a big bag of Doritos. It was like around during the winter, where like a bag of Doritos, cans of Coke and stuff, and like, you know, like the Reese's. And we're sitting like right there. I forgot what movie we had seen, but we're sitting right there. And you know how the guy comes in checking, looking and stuff, right? He looks over and he sees all of us. There we are. We're passing a bag of Doritos around, just sitting there. And he looked at us, and my brother was with us, and he walked over to us. And my brother was like, "What?" I was like, "We paid." And he turned, walked off. But it was a great time.
Yeah, it gets expensive these days, you know.
Yeah, it does. It does. It gets really expensive, but I have enjoyed tonight having both you guys back on again. I love it.
Yes.
I love it. And
yeah, thanks, man. It was really great.
Yeah, no problem. Is there anything that you want to share before we close out on the podcast tonight?
Well, just as always, man, we encourage folks that like high quality, low budget independent films to check us out at theaterofterror.net, or check out the Theater of Terror on Facebook. And that's theater spelled T-H-E-A-T-R-E. Check us out for our upcoming projects. Keep your eyes peeled for our Indiegogo campaign, which will probably be launching by the end of this month, to raise some funds so that we could bring the audience some kick-ass locally shot horror films. So yeah, that's my final message, Todd. I know we have a Grindhouse coming up.
Yep. So the next Grindhouse Nights Film Festival is coming up February 29th, Leap Year Madness, at Roxy and Duke's Roadhouse in Dunellen, New Jersey. We've got some amazing short films lined up and some great live entertainment. And if anyone listening has a creepy film they'd like to submit, submissions end this Saturday, actually, January the 25th. So get your submissions in now on filmfreeway.com/Grindhouse Nights Film Festival. And we hope to see everyone at the next event, February 29th.
Nice, nice. Thank you. Thank you, Todd, Tom. As always, man, you always always love having you on and discussing movies and discussing about everything in between and everything that you guys do for independent movies. And before we do close out, I do want to mention that you can follow more of the Everett Lee Show around podcastcity.net. You can head over there to check out shows such as the Everett Lee Show, The Imaginarium with Scott and Todd, Super Radio Brothers, Final Score, Deathmatch Wrestle Podcast, Wrestle Podcast, and much, much more over on podcastcity.net. Follow them on Facebook, Podcast City Network. Give them a thumbs up and send them a tweet over on Twitter at podcastcitynet. You can follow more Everett Lee over on Everett Lee Show on Facebook. Send me a tweet over on Twitter at the Everett Lore Score Lee, and follow me on the following for the audio portions of this podcast and previous release podcast over on YouTube channel Everett Lee Show, Stitcher Radio, iTunes, and Podbeam. Download those apps, give a rating and a review. I certainly would appreciate it. And that is it for the Everett Lee Show. I want to wish everyone a good night, and I'll see you again next week for another episode of the Everett Lee Show. Peace.